Next is our school presentation, of which we've partaken already, but now we get to hear what it was all about.
Right, and ask questions. Well, we do this a couple of times a year, and this year, the news in food nutrition is we've taken on some new programs, and we also have our farm-to-school coordinator. And the goal that we're trying to do with our program this year is to become less of a heat and serve and more of a scratch cooking and serve. So everybody gets, all the schools have a subscription to Taste of Home magazine, and they have, we're picking out recipes every month to sample and try so that we can start students early with more scratch cooking instead of, say, you know, always having the chicken nuggets or the pizza, which is fine every once in a while, but we'd really like to expose our students to something different and come up with other things besides Stromboli, which is always a hit. So I'll start with the farm to school. We have Caitlin, who's working with us, and she's going, and we also made an investment into 4 Vitamix blenders. They come with the covers, they're commercial, they're pretty top of the line, and the goal isn't so much smoothies as it is things like hummus and other things that we can make with them, although we are doing a lot of smoothie sampling, and Caitlin has been awesome in doing that. She's taking them around, and we split a blender between Bates and Cornerstone. I hate to call them a blender because they're way too expensive to call them blender. But, and Wiling Creekside and then the high school and Mill Creek each have their own. So we're kind of getting used to them. My interns that I get from U of M have actually come up with a whole easy recipe book and instruction manual how to clean. So they're actually doing the training. And so far, I think they've been a big hit. I mean, we'll be able to do a lot of things like that cucumber puree and just a lot of things where before we were always taking things to the high school and having them done in the RoboCoop and then transporting them back. So the kids have been, Caitlin's really excited because the kids are having kale smoothies and, you know, it's just a nice, fun exposure. It's also for all the lunchroom students, not just food and nutrition, so we're exposing all the students. And that's kind of our goal. We don't want to just focus on hot lunch students. We want to provide exposure to all of the students. So that's, and Caitlin's doing a great job with creating liaisons between the local farmers and Dexter Food and Nutrition. In other words, we're getting phone numbers, we're getting the W-9s kind of filled out. Yeah, so we're creating a process and a template for an easier way for them to contact us and us to contact them, and just kind of set up that merchant path between the local farmers and us. And, you know, we've always done well with lesser apples. This year we're doing frosty apples. We've done well with asparagus from Jackson and squash, but the things we really want to start doing are more gourmet lettuces, which I don't think kale's gourmet anymore, but, you know, just getting more local products in. It's a lot more fun to say these cherry tomatoes were grown at such a large farm rather than just, you know, coming from Van Uden or something. So we're really trying to focus on that, and it's a huge, it's just really great for Caitlin to be doing this project. I'm so happy that we have her as a liaison, and it's a big help to us being able to set this up. It's a lot of, it just takes time to create that relationship, so this has been really helpful. The other thing, Dexter was one of 3 districts in the state to be on a lettuce pilot that the USDA is doing, which means we get whole heads of lettuce, red leaf, romaine, bib, regular, iceberg, and then green leaf lettuce. We get them in a whole head so they're fresh. So because we're doing that, we had to invest in salad spinners and the choppers, which we got those for Mill Creek and the high school. So we're preparing the lettuce for all the schools. And we actually had an email from a parent who was really impressed with the lettuce that she had at Bates. She just said, I think it needs to be cut a little smaller. So, anyway, So we're very excited, and we always have a pile of sand at the bottom of the spinner and at, you know, going, because they're pretty fresh. So we were happy to be on that pilot. What that means is that we are getting like 8 heads of lettuce in a case for $4. So it's a huge, it's just a great win-win for all of us. And the USDA, we're giving them our feedback, and so I'm really happy that we jumped on that. Okay, other things. We are growing. I think most of you know that we're now doing senior nutrition. We have a dedicated person that in expense line and revenue line for senior nutrition, and we're really happy about it because, well, for one thing, it makes sense because Mill Creek is here, the senior center is here, and it's if something happens, if we need fresher food, we're right there. Most of the meals that we're preparing are for Meals on Wheels. To do that, we worked with the senior center, and they were doing, I get excited about this, so if it gets boring, they were doing crimping, you know, aluminum pans with the tops and crimping. So we were at a food show, and I saw the, what we call the, it's actually a sealing machine. And you can have the sealing machine, you don't have to pay for it, they will give it to you, and then you just pay for the containers and the plastic that goes over. And the nice thing about it for seniors, which we love, is that it's microwavable or it can go in the oven. And it just makes a really nice product, or it can go in the freezer. I mean, there's just all sorts of really nice things that go with it. Plus, it's more efficient, and the senior nutrition staff that the senior center employs are just, if you ever want to see something really cool, you can go and see it. It seals it all up, and Chris has a little bit of knowledge of that. We were talking about it, but I'm really excited about that. It's also great from scratch cooking. We're getting recipes and trying things, and I like that we can support as a district, support our seniors, and I just think it's a win-win. So, and then we're also doing, we kind of branched into IPSE through our WISD program. We're doing the, we're doing the International High School Meals at 510 Emmerich, which I think is the old East Middle School in IPSE. And we got the Middle School Academy students that are actually IPSE students that are now in that building. So we're feeding those kids as well, and they are extremely happy to have our food versus Little Run / IPSE food. And the other thing we did over the summer, I'm sure you know that IPSE and Little Run, that whole thing is going really smoothly. Well, when they combined, when they went together, nobody made any plans for summer feeding for the 600 students a day that go to IPSE and Little Run that combined, and nobody had made plans or allowances for doing the summer feeding for those kids. So these programs, the great thing about them is the kids come to summer school or programs, or they go to the athletics, and they always get a lunch. And so Brian Marcel called up and said, "Do you think you could do this?" I said, "Sure, Brian, we'll do it." And anyway, everybody was pink slipped, and so we had to hire 2 people at the Sharon knows, because we always talk about this. We had to figure out how we were going to pay them. And we were originally going to use IPSE staff, but they would have lost their health insurance and their unemployment benefits. So then we had to go outside of IPSE staff and just come up with 2 people to work it. And so instead of, it really helped our program, because instead of doing like 500 programs a day, we were doing 1,100 for the month of July. So, I mean, Mary and Kathy Sultana that work at Mill Creek, and our driver Stacy, they just, I mean, it was like seamless. They did an awesome job, and they did, I mean, again, everybody was really happy with Dexter. So that's my world.
That's it.
And this is a meal that we do for our kids. We don't do a lot of wraps. We kind of do them as needed at the high school, but the kids have really been enjoying kale salad. Of course, they always like cookies. And we also have been asked for the last 2 years to do the lunch on the lawn up in Lansing. And it's where the state of Michigan school nutrition program invites all the legislators to come and eat with us. So they all were love the food. Rebecca Warren, I guess Senator Warren, is going to be coming to our schools, and she was excited. So it was, again, you know.
Who did the food?
And the high school staff did this, and they just did an awesome job. So it's truly a, they just are, except for Sharon. Sharon, I have what to think about this next time and get you your pizza, but Sharon's like the epitome of an elementary student.
Eating-wise,
yeah. Pizza, hamburgers, and...
Spaghetti.
Yeah, so, and mashed potatoes. So that's where we're at, and if you have any questions or...
I want to just commend you for all of the initiatives you're taking on, and I think the farm to school food is really exciting for our kids. It's obviously more nutritious, and it also helps our local economy. You know, when we're buying from our local farmers versus the commodity on the commodities, and it's wonderful. So, and to kids all know how to microwave, but to actually be able to serve food that's made from scratch, I think it's a great movement. So I appreciate your effort and everything.
Well, Caitlin is taking that. I mean, the credit goes to her. We, you know, what we also want the kids to do is not have an assembly line apple. Like, I was checking out the Frosty apples. They're a little bit smaller, but, you know, there might be a bruise on them. There might be, like, a little hole in them. And you know what? That's okay. That's real fruit. It's not, you know, assembly line apple that one gets kicked off because, you know, it makes sense.
Do we have any extra funding outside for the farm to school movement, or is that?
We don't. We would if we were over 50% free and reduced. Dexter is the fourth lowest in the state free and reduced percentage. So I think ahead of us is Birmingham, Roseal, Dexter, and I can't remember. Yes, you're right. So that means that even though I think it shouldn't include any school district, that the initiatives to get rebates and from the government and little subsidies aren't there for us, which is why what Caitlin is doing is so important. I mean, and I do jump on everything I can, like the lettuce, the USD lettuce pilot is huge. I mean, there's times when you can't even buy a head of lettuce for $4.50, and we're getting it all. So that's really exciting. And the lettuce looks, I mean, the lettuce that you have in the wraps is part of that pilot. So again, it's a really nice program, and I'm glad we're on.
Well, isn't Caitlin's half of her salary or some part of her salary paid for by the foundation through the
Yes.
Coalition?
All of it.
All of it?
Yeah. And she, like you said, she's very passionate about what she does. She's extremely patient, which really helps. And she's just, I mean, her diplomatic skills are awesome. I mean, she's like the perfect person for that job. She's just awesome.
And then there's gardens. Do we use any of those?
We're doing the high school garden, and well, we're not. I mean, the high school garden's coming along, the Creekside garden. We've used herbs and tomatoes, basil from those gardens, which are going to be more like exposure gardens. I mean, we have a big district, and we feed a lot of kids on a daily basis. So it's really good, like for the tastings for the cherry tomatoes. Caitlin did the basil from the Creekside garden. So, and the kids really enjoy that. And they're like, this tastes so much better than the other tomatoes we have. And they're cherry tomatoes. But anyway, it's whatever it takes to get them in their mouth. So.
And isn't Brett the smoothie meister of the district?
He might people, so any smoothies we have to do, we need to be able to repeat. I mean, anybody can do a great smoothie with ice cream and this and that, but ours, we have to use our fruits and vegetables, and kids have to learn to like them that way, because we're not going to do ice cream smoothies. It's just, it's just not going to work.
Any other questions, comments? Sarah, thank you very much.
Thank you. Should I?
Thank you.
Some of this, the lemonade one?
Yeah.
Yes, you may.
We have a lot of food left over, so does anybody want to take any home?
I will.
I will.
Yeah.
Okay, great. I'll go get some little bags and bring them back, and then you guys can help yourself.
Thank you very much.
Mr. Superintendent?
As you can see, food service is going really well. Sarah's doing a great job, and I gotta tell you, being new to the district and see it being, going to multiple districts, our food service is pretty impressive. It really is. It's a lot more than Bosco sticks.
Still the best.
Everybody loves Bosco. Few things. We received our letter from the Department of Ed for Mill Creek and the reward school status for high performance. We'll have a copy of the letter in the next agenda. Currently, we're putting together some data packages that will give us useful data at each level of the organization, as far as the classroom, the building, the district, and the board level. We're waiting, the state updated the file that had all the MUT data in it, so we don't have access to any of the data other than last year's until for 2 more weeks. I've been going back and forth with them. That's all we're waiting for, and then we push the button.
For this year's MUT?
Well, we have. No, last year's meet, we gotta wait for this year's, but I'm building a report so that it's a quick turnaround in December or January.
Oh, really?
So we have it, it'll be, as soon as they put the, give us access to the old files, then we're good.
Prior years, where are we getting it, like until March or April, or?
Well, sort of. What this'll do, they usually release, for example, meat testing is wrapping up the retakes this week. They'll give us the raw data files in around December 20 for internal review. System we'll be using, we'll be able to turn that around so we can actually do something with it before the public release is usually in February or so.
Oh, okay.
So we'll actually be well all ready. Just building it all is just chasing down the files.
Sure.
So I'm trying to go all the way back to about 06, 07 so we can get trend data and be able to follow kids as they move up and see what's happening. Also working on a preliminary dashboard, it's part of the entry plan. Identifying first what key indicator data measures us effectively, at least initially it measures effectively. So what I've been working on, we have like 2 and 3 year trend data, but I'm building comparison reports and working with Jeff Day, who's actually now in charge of that part. Get a list of districts to kind of benchmark ourselves with based on similar demographics. So working on the reports. Now the fun stuff. I asked Mike Babineau for an update on athletics. So boys soccer won districts. They were SEC white champs. They play in regionals tomorrow versus Sturgis over at Jackson. Girls swimming, SEC white champions again. That's 10 in a row or so.
It's like 16.
Is it 16?
This year it was 16, yeah.
That's awesome. Correct him. Girls golf won the SEC White Championship, finished 9th at MHSAA State Tournament. Girls cross country won the SEC White. And boys tennis finished 2nd in the league, and they missed the state tournament by 1 point. Mm-hmm. So that's pretty good ball.
Yeah.
It's really good.
Is that it?
That's what you got.
Thank you. Steven, Abby?
You want to go, Abby?
Sure. Loyal.
Is this the good?
No, I'm not going to talk about the good news now.
Oh, sorry.
That's my, like, that's like personal news.
Oh, okay. What about school?
No. It's like personal news. Anyway, so yeah, like with Dr. Timmons said, fall sports are kind of like wrapping up. It's like 2 weeks or so, most sports are ending, so that's like pretty exciting. Everyone's excited for the winter season to kind of move inside. It's getting colder. I think we're supposed to have like snow on Wednesday or something ridiculous.
Are you looking for for a snow day?
Yeah.
How tall tonight they make up these?
Yeah, we were having some really, we got lucky with Dennis last year, so we have high hopes. No, but so everyone's kind of excited to move inside for the winter sports. The Chelsea game was on Friday, which was a heartbreak, but it was fun and it was exciting. I thought we were finally going to win, like end this 17-year streak. I don't know. All the football players were extremely confident, but
that could have been the problem.
Yeah, apparently it didn't really pay off. But I mean, it was still fun. I know there was like a email sent out from Mr. Moran about like some like problems with student drinking at the games, and I personally didn't see any problems this game. I thought it was better, and they were, like, had like good check-ins or whatever. I noticed when I got there, so I mean, I thought that went over well. That's what they're trying to accomplish, so it was nice, fun game.
Good.
I don't really have too much to say. I didn't go to the game, and everything, so I don't. She kind of covered everything.
Okay. Thank you,
but you are on the boys' cross country team. I didn't hear Dr. Timmis say anything about the boys' cross country team.
He didn't put any update.
We're not doing too great this year. We don't have any fourth year runners on the team. Everybody graduated, and we've got like one kid, one senior on the team right now. So.
Is this a building year?
Yeah, it's a building year. Next year we'll be killing it, but this year we got to recuperate a little bit.
But tradition never graduates.
Ooh.
Oh. Just giving you our death. Next year.
Next year.
All right. Okay. Public? No public. Consent.
I move that the consent agenda be approved as presented.
I'll second. All in favor? Opposed? Did we get a second?
Yes.
Okay.
I do have a question for the students, though. What is the perception of the PSAT test that's given to sophomores or juniors?
I took it. I didn't take it this year, obviously, but I took it last year. Mm-hmm. I never ended up taking the SAT. I mean, it was like a fine, like practice test. But yeah, I never ended up taking the SAT, so I guess it was
waste of time.
Yeah, I guess.
I think a lot.
Did
of
you take it?
I took it this year. A lot of my friends took it. They like it. I mean, they like having the option. It's a good practice thing to have. I mean, because most of them, like, I know I take the PSAT, I've taken it like every year since like eighth grade, just because.
Because you can.
But it's a good way to practice taking these standardized tests. Not a lot
of kids. Practice for the ACT?
Well, I mean, it's for the, I've taken both, but at least with the PSAT, I mean, it's still a standardized
test. You've taken the ACT and the SAT already? You're a junior, right?
Yeah.
Okay.
You can take the ACT whenever you want.
Well, I think it's like, yeah, I think it's good practice for like, because I like, you know, the juniors take like all their standardized tests like towards the end of the year. So I guess it's good practice for kids, because some kids don't end up doing well on the ACT, and then they like take the SAT and end up doing like really well on that. So I guess it's like good practice for students that end up like going in that path, which is what they might.
You never really take standardized tests in school, like really big, heavy tests. So it's good to get practice in for it, just because if you get thrown into the ACT your first time, you've got this massive 4-hour test in front of you. You don't know what to do. So it's just good for students to have the option to, even if it is the SAT, it's still beneficial.
A lot of colleges just say send your best score. Ivy League wants to see all of them, but University of Michigan, you can take the ACT several times and just send your best.
Yeah, no, I know that, but that's, I was really more focused on the PSAT, what the real advantage to taking the test is. For.
Well, if you do really well, you get a scholarship, but that's a small percentage of kids.
It's less than, that's 1% of 1% or something. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Okay,
so if you were to tell Dr. Timmis something, you would perhaps say that it would be nice to train students in proper test taking as they come up through the district.
Yeah, because I know we offer classes, but they cost money.
Right.
Yeah.
But we do offer classes like through the school. There's a lot of classes around.
So. There's a lot in Ann Arbor.
Yep.
I know some urban high schools spend months preparing their kids for taking standardized tests.
move on to the one action item that we have, the PAC representative recommendation. We'll take a motion and then we'll discuss.
I move that Vanessa Stewart serve on the WISD Parent Advisory Committee to represent Webster Union in the school.
Support. So any questions for Barb? Barb, do you have any?
Vanessa is a parent of a first grade student at Cornerstone. She's very interested in becoming actively involved. She's replacing Geraldine Grossman, who served for 8 years and stepped down because of family reasons. So their terms are typically for 2 years, so Vanessa's term will end July 31st of 2015. But if there's any other interest for people to step up, we can continue to move on with her. The other parent is Grant Egler, who's also been serving for a number of years. We have two reps in the district.
They're pretty active.
They meet once a month, the second Tuesday of every month at the ISD.
Is the other parent someone with an older child in the district?
Yes, she's a high school student.
Any other questions, comments? We have a motion and a second. All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion is passed. Next item is a discussion item on the Washtenaw Education Options Consortium. And you should have received a recommendation from our superintendent. Do you want to talk about that?
Yes, the Washtenaw Educational Options Consortium has three programs. The first is the WAE program, which is an alternative education program that we've been participating in. I think we have five students in that.
Four.
Then we have the Early College Alliance, which is out of Eastern Michigan, or housed at Eastern Michigan University, and then the Washtenaw International High School, which is an IB program for the county. It's a regional program. For those programs, if a student attends the WHI or the WAE program, the district pays the full foundation to fund the program. When a student attends ECA, we pay 95% of the foundation. Currently, there are four students at WAE. As of the last report I received, there were seven Dexter resident students that attended ECA through schools of choice from two different districts. I don't know the reasons why they attend through those districts. I've asked and didn't get a lot of detail yet. Continue to work on that. The WEOC is under a little bit of change. It was part of the ISD. Now they are setting themselves up as a separate board of directors. The board of directors are a combination of superintendents from all the county districts. And
for just the participants or all of them?
If a district participates in any of the programs, there's a seat at the table. So because they're setting themselves up differently, their intent was originally to get boards to either opt out, basically it was supposed to be an opt out by October 1st. Because of the timing of when they released all the information, instead of they pushed it back to December 1st, maybe because it's an opt-out. And it's a little unique to have a new entity and then to say, well, if you don't want to be part of it, you got to tell us. So that's a little different for process. So based on what I know right now, understanding the programs, my recommendation is to stay with participating in the WAE program. But to opt out of WHI, because we have our own IB program, and to opt out of ECA for the 2014-15 school year. I wanted to give this as a starting point for the discussion. I don't know enough I'm still learning as fast as I can. Talk to a lot of people, and as far as ECA, I think it's a good program. I don't know enough to say that it's something we should or shouldn't, that we should do yet. I wanted to start at the point. So I know that's where we have discussion.
The seven students that we have now, they're going to a school of choice district, and then that district is sending them to ECA?
And then sending the foundation.
And then that 95% of the foundation goes with them?
Yes.
Is there any disadvantage to having us have students participating in ECA? I mean, obviously the foundation grant or 95%, but we're either going to send 95% of the foundation grant or 100%. via another district.
Right.
Is there any disadvantage to Dexter participating?
As of right now, the way ECA operates is the students don't, they don't follow the same graduation requirements that we would offer or have tied to a diploma from Dexter. So the one piece is being able to understand that if we allow students to go there that are our students, we're changing their graduation requirements to fit the ECA requirements, which isn't uncommon for an early college, but it's a little shift because we've had every other program, we basically follow the graduation requirements for the district. The WAE program is a little variation. ECA is a much more drastic. They don't necessarily take all the high school classes. They end up with 60 credits, which is great.
60 college credits?
So it's a matter of whether the board is okay with doing that.
Plus, we have no control over the content or the way those classes are taught, correct?
Correct. So according to the slotting mechanism, and I received the update today about 4 o'clock, we would be allotted up to 16 seats in ECA if we were to participate. However, I believe the district could say that they only want 1 seat or 2 seats. We can name already.
But whatever you name, you have to pay.
No, only if they're used.
Only if they're used.
Now, was it ECA where they would participate in the home district graduation?
Yes.
Right.
And not WAC, not WCC. And or not YHI, which the IP program. So the Dexter student would go to Eastern, but they would walk across our stage.
And right. And receive the Dexter community.
Oh, really?
Diploma.
Oh.
I'm almost proud of you.
Okay.
So that's the hang up with the, they get these college credits, presumably. But otherwise, their distribution requirements are different from those of our high school. They may not be eligible for a diploma, but for the fact that they're in this special program.
Correct.
Would you be able to provide information about where the differences are between what the ECA requirements and how that lines up or not with our district graduation requirements? That would be helpful. You know, I don't know if we're talking about. You know, we require a PE elective if that's where we're misaligned or where the congruence and incongruence is, that would be helpful. I know of one student who went to the ECA last year and chose to come back to Dexter this year, now as a senior, and is dual enrolled, decided taking 3 classes at Eastern as a dual enrolled student and other courses at Dexter High School better met the career objective. I don't understand all the reasons that caused them to initially go there and then to return to Dexter. And I pass the name along to Dr. Timmis because it may be worthwhile for us to actually know from a student firsthand what that experience was.
And it's a good program. It's logistically, it's quite a distance for a student from Dexter to be driving every day. I think there's potential down the road to be able to set up some kind of Western Washtenaw setup in this area, because the districts that struggle with participating in Chelsea, it's mostly homeschool students that end up enrolling. Manchester, I don't believe, participates. And then in YHI, Chelsea, Manchester, and Dexter, I believe they don't participate. I think Manchester does. Celine doesn't participate in the ECA.
I think the distance is a barrier for families, but I'm not sure I would view that as a barrier for us to whether we approve it or not. I mean, then that's up to a family to decide whether that can commute. I'm generally in favor of the idea of offering our students choices, so it would be helpful to know how the curriculum meets our graduation requirements or not.
My question is the concern that that what ECA is offering does not meet our standard, or is the concern that they've left us behind and are doing something different? Like,
they're doing something very different.
Right, more advanced, do you feel like, or just maybe not quite as...
Depends. we historically have not participated. I don't know what the initial reasons were. The program's been around for quite a while. I've been digging through trying to talk to everybody I could to get the story. There doesn't seem to be real clarity on why we had it initially.
So I guess I'm just kind of wondering, if it's a more advanced education, then it's probably okay, you know, unless there's some different information. If the concern is that there are really critical gaps that are being left, or that it doesn't somehow meet our standards, then we wouldn't want to put our diploma on it. But so that's my question. I don't know that you'd have the answer to
that. If it's different but more advanced,
fine.
That
in my opinion.
Fine. But if it's leaves something out that we feel
that's
is
important.
Because you can pretty much focus on what your field of study was, and you can essentially drop English language arts and take mathematics and science classes if that was your correct. So,
I mean, it used to be up until this year that the credits were not transferable in Michigan to a Research One institution, but the state changed it in the school or in the that they had that Michigan State and Wayne State had to accept them as transferable credits.
Right.
That doesn't mean they're going to necessarily transfer them one-to-one for exact courses, but they have to count. I don't know how the universities are handling that yet, because that act didn't officially start October 1st for that budget.
Well, that's a pretty big difference, because 60
difference.
Credits is the equivalent of 2 years of undergraduate education, and if now Michigan State are forced to accept those, I gotta tell you, I'm a little dubious, because I'm not aware of any student leaving our high school with more than 12 to 14 credits at Michigan. 60 sounds like pretty astounding. I mean, and the monetary value potentially to a family is 2 years of tuition at State or Michigan. Those are some pretty dramatic figures that you're talking about.
The ECA, though, student can go fifth year, correct?
Correct.
And so that makes a difference. If you can go fifth year, but it's paid through by a foundation grant. So they're essentially getting that fifth year free.
Right. And there's no reason a local school district can't set up something.
Sure.
Is there a point where up to this point you take general classes, and as the kids are ready, they begin branching out into college classes? Or do they just go straight in, and they can, as Ron said, can they just forget their English if they're not interested in it? Or is there a certain standard they have to meet before they're allowed to move on?
No, they need to complete an equivalent of a high school diploma.
Mm-hmm.
The state law requires 4 years of English. The mathematics they would normally have to complete in order to get the 60 credits. They're not necessarily getting an associate's degree through the program, they're getting 60 credits.
Mm-hmm.
Some programs are set firmly on getting the associates. Eastern, I don't believe, offers an associate's. I think that's the only channel.
I think Washington, you can get associates. You can come out of there with an associate's.
Washington Technical Middle College.
Yeah.
Yes. Yeah, out of that program, you can.
Actually, I know a couple years ago we had David
Duggar.
Yeah. I think it would be helpful for me, at least, if we could see if he could come back and talk to the board. It was probably 2 years ago or so. And
not quite that long.
Yeah, I think it's more recent.
But I remember him saying that they were graduating kids into some fairly prestigious schools outside of Michigan as well. I'd like to see confirmation, because if it's really a rigorous program, and it's seen as a rigorous program by schools, not that they're being forced by state law, but because on its own merits, it's being interpreted by very competitive colleges and universities as a rigorous program, then I would think that would be very popular among some families and kids who were very focused on what they want going forward. But
do we know why Celine is not participating? I don't know.
We have a lot of kids who go to one school for 2 years now and then transfer to Michigan or another school because they want to save money and accumulate distribution. This allows them to achieve that in a much shorter time frame if that's what they choose to do. I don't know what the downside is.
Well, but you mentioned that we could do it, a district could do it themselves. Is that, would that be a reason why you'd be less inclined to do it through the ECA, is to open the opportunity?
Yes and no. I mean, if we got into it and we opened it up for students, we could start to build our own program here if that's what was in the strategic planning, if that made sense, according to what we wanted to do. So long term, that would be logical in a lot of ways, but that's going to take a while to build. So the question is whether we want to do something for kids now or not, and whether it's, I don't know if anybody was on the board when their original decision was made not to participate.
Yeah, no, I think everybody was on the board. Okay. We don't have a whole lot of turnover here. It was with Mary, so
I've only been
it
here since I never worked with Mary.
I know that historically our high school principal was
just
not in
like
favor
okay.
of the program.
Well, but for the reasons that we've talked about, the fact that we don't have control of the classes that they take and they don't graduate according to the criteria that we've set by policy. So there are other options. I mean you can have two different diplomas. You can have our community or our Dexter Community Schools diploma, and you can have another diploma so that they would be differentiated when they went to another school. But then you have to think about, well, if we let that be another way to get a diploma at Dexter, could we let homeschoolers do the same thing? Let them provide all of the documentation that says that their students took all the appropriate classes and now what would prevent us from having to give them a diploma? Because we don't have control over them either.
Well, what would prevent you is that you have agreed to it and that I don't know homeschoolers need or want a diploma from Dexter.
But I'm just using
I've been asked it about the districts in the past.
Yeah.
We've had students show up their senior year and say they want to come in and get a diploma.
Without fulfilling the requirements to get there?
Well, they fulfill it at home.
Yeah. So it just depends on.
But you decide what credits you accept. Yeah. So there are accredited homeschool organizations that are grading papers for the families and you pay a tuition to go there. And then there's just mom putting stuff together. And I can't imagine if you would. I mean, if you wanted to, you could. But if you didn't want to, I don't think you would have to.
No, we have policies of transfer credits. So, or other stuff.
And what would stop it would be that you would say, we stop, here's the line, we're drawing it, I think.
So. Sounds like I got some questions to look up and revise the after finding out the question or the answers to that. It sounds like there's some interest in participating in ECA, depending on the answers to these questions.
And Adrian, you were in an ideal situation where Adrian College was virtually across the street from you. Did you have something like this set up down there?
No, we did. Can't do an early college program with a private school. You can only work with a public.
Oh, really? Okay. And
so we would have had to work with Jackson Community College.
Oh, okay. So it wasn't as easy as having
right.
a professor walk across the street. And
we okay. did build a middle college program as a county out of Jackson Community
okay.
Campus Engineering.
Okay.
The program's quality was
right.
still
right.
it's a working process.
Sure. Okay. Well, it can only be from public schools. Okay.
Because then the state still has
yep.
control. The
state has, right, okay.
That makes sense. Then these kids in the ECA, they attend classes at Eastern, is that?
Yeah. Yep.
They attend regular Eastern classes.
Not from the get-go, from what I understand, but
that's fine.
Is the first year at
yep.
least, they're in their own contained program,
right.
and they have to meet certain criteria and demonstrate in the four courses
right.
as well as soft skills, you know, kind of work habits and
study skills.
Study skills, and before they will allow them to take the college classes.
So there shouldn't be big gaps, but you know,
sometimes there are students, so they come in ninth grade and early college programs, and when they do assess them, they can get them a course or two in, of the college courses, depending on where they're at. They usually use, what is it called? And as soon as I start to mention, I forget the name of the assessment. It's one only colleges use for, a lot of community colleges, the Compass test.
Oh, yeah. I've seen the Compass test.
Okay, any other discussion on that? Next item is our fiscal year end information that Sharon put together.
The information had been presented to the Finance Committee about 2 weeks ago, and we have reviewed it. And one of the issues that we have to decide is the allocation of fund balance, our unassigned fund balance needed to be above 5%. Is that correct, Chair?
The unassigned fund balance needed to cover the current operational expense over revenue, or the current expense over revenue that has been subsequently passed for the 13-14 year.
The budget
numbers, right, because of the budget that was adopted by the board. And I didn't get you that part yet, but the reserve part will be coming at the next meeting, because I forgot to do it.
So the 5%, is that by policy?
No, it's not. We had to have enough undesignated in order to cover the current board authorized expenses over revenue. That would bring it just to zero.
Right.
The board policy targets 3-5% is undesignated. So I guess that, you know, maybe we need to define that at some point, because the fact that we have 5%, but it's all been allocated to the current budget year, you know, we'll have to maybe look at something like that. But that's been the recommendation that will come forward for the audit.
So the 19.2% is total fund balance to revenue?
To expenses.
To expenses. And that's, where do we sit in terms of other schools for that number?
We won't see what other schools have for the 12-13 year until about next May, April or May. But
if we look back to last year.
Yeah, I mean, last year we were at 25%, so we were in really good shape. And I don't have that number, I don't know.
You know that we're in an elite class there, because the state keeps threatening to take away anything if we manage better than 15%. Now, that's a lousy reason to knock it down from 22 or whatever it was down to 19. But in their brilliance, universities, which have probably 10 times their operating budget invested, they get one measuring stick, and then we just get the whip on the other end.
It's called an endowment.
I think there's a very, very small percentage of districts that are even 15.
There is.
And so I think that we are in a very high differentiated level from most of the districts in the state.
And it does get skewed a little bit with some of the really small districts
that
fluctuate all over the place, depending on, because their budgets are so small that one person can send them between 10% and 20% in 1 year. But other than that, it's a very small number of those.
They actually count some things in reserves that shouldn't be part of fund balance too, because of the stupid accounting system. Liability for you incurred but not received bills. That's not fund balance by any accounting standard I've ever heard of. That's not a big deal, but it just shows that the state doesn't care to do anything normal in terms of evaluating what we're doing.
The table that's identified as number 3, that's operational versus audit.
Right.
So when you look at the revenue over expenses, operational for the June, November, and then the actual ends up being about 600,000 less than all those other numbers, is that, this is probably gonna sound stupid, but is that good?
Well, if you look at the next page, that will explain where all of those positive variances are at.
Let's go a kind of a gross overview for a second, put this thing in perspective.
Okay, go ahead.
I asked Sharon in a conversation a little earlier to disaggregate, great new word I learned up here. How did we really do this past year against previous years if you take out the health insurance issue? Because I don't want that thing to muddy up what we really manage in the district. I think we really need to take a look and see how did our leadership in the buildings and in the programs do compared to past years. And I think that it was pretty comparable. And I think that there was somewhere in the neighborhood of like over $1 million of positive variances if you take the health insurance out of the equation. And I think that if you go back over past years, that number, positive variances run, I don't know, probably from 800,000 or something on up to about 2 million. And someplace along the way in the last 10 years, we finally came to the conclusion that we needed to quit managing numbers so that we could sleep better at night and have these big positive variances and shortchange the kids that were in school that year. And so we started budgeting where we would have expenses over revenue budgeted, but our goal was always to have the actual break even or better. And I think if you go through the, if you take out all of the goofy stuff from where we planned for stuff out of reserves and everything, I believe that's the 415,000 expense over revenue. Had the health insurance met the pattern of the past, as many years as we can go back probably, certainly the last 4 or 5 years where you pull out hard data, we would have normally had something in the neighborhood of a, I think it averaged around $300,000 positive variance, and it ranged up to as high as $600,000, I think.
For health?
For health insurance, positive variance. That's always one of the big factors when we were getting these $1 million to $2 million positive variances. That was the biggest single factor. And so if you take the 215 or 207 or 230, whatever the loss, the shortfall is, and make that 300,000 positive, we actually would have had a positive bottom line last year. And I think it's really important as we go forward. If people want to make a decision that says health insurance is going to tank like this every year, then I guess you budget accordingly. If you decide that this year's an anomaly, then what we've done for the last 10, 15, 20 years actually works well and has added to the bottom line and would probably do so in the future. I don't have a crystal ball to tell you whether it's going to continue tanking or whether it's going to turn around. But I do think we want to be careful that we don't let one year that's totally abnormal change dramatically how we approach budgeting and setting up programs for kids. It's just our goal is to have the stability of programs, not manage numbers so that they look better when you hand them out on a bumper sticker. And I think we really need to go through this thing carefully. And I think we need to truly understand that last year, except for health insurance, was a pretty standard year. And the way things were managed by principals and program directors was consistent with what's been done over as many years as I can remember looking at this stuff. And you can go through and you can poke around at all the different pieces, but I think that overall picture is the most critical thing, and it brings up the issue that we really need to grapple with. Was last year the new norm, or was it an anomaly?
Other comments, questions?
That's helpful historical perspective. Thank you.
I don't take it as historical. Historical means that it's in the past and has no, you know, it's interesting, but it's no value. I think that the norms for the last few years should be considered as predictors of the future.
I didn't intend it to be that way. I think it's useful to see how we performed in the past, and I think that often is the best predictor for the future.
Other comments?
Well, yeah.
Well, go ahead.
Well, I think I followed everything that Kit said, but I would also, I think that it's probably true that savings on healthcare costs have contributed to the financial health of the district on an annualized and consistent basis, and that having a stable plan and state financial stability is crucial in stable programming. But I will also say that my interpretation of the downside, and that it doesn't really matter from the district's perspective as a matter of planning whether this last year was an aberration or not, because we have also planned for that contingency. And because my understanding of the contract, and I've expressed this view in the finance committee as well, so it won't come as a surprise to anyone on the finance committee, but my understanding of our agreement is that we've negotiated a way the downside of financial costs. If, in other words, if there's an increase in spending in the health benefit, that's part of this.
I have a question before you continue. Maybe Chris can answer. Is this a legitimate discussion at this setting, or do we need to move this to a different setting? Because I think we're maybe treading on a real slippery slope here, where we may be headed. What you're saying is valid, Michael, whether that be said here in a public meeting or whether it's something that we need to do in a different venue. I'm not sure what the Fair Labor Practices and all that stuff is, but I know that we had a problem earlier this year when Denny was here. Some stuff was said at the board, and I was told very clearly, and maybe some of the others, that had anybody challenged that, we had a guaranteed loser in court. And that's maybe something's going to get addressed tomorrow night, but I think we've got to be very, very careful about some of the things that are said in the wrong setting.
You just talked in generalities of the overall budget, not identified by any employee group or a specific. You just talked about as far as just the reserves overall as a district, then we're okay, but if it gets into specific collective bargaining groups, then probably should
have a discussion with the committee. I'm just concerned about what we want to do tonight.
Joe?
I have some things that would be very uncomfortable for me to not say, but probably inappropriate for me to say if
we
were having a public discussion. Pardon me?
You're in public, you say whatever you want.
Yeah, well.
It's not a two-way street, unfortunately.
It doesn't look like it, but you're wearing a hat, so he
yes.
does, when he says something that's different than somebody else,
I would rather keep some conversations that I think deserve privacy because they have been a part of negotiations within that realm. It's just, it makes it a lot easier for us when we are bargaining if we are confident that we're not going to be having the discussion in public.
To turn the worm a little bit, though, had it been for the reserve that was the set-asides, this bottom line would have been, what, $207,000 worse if we had not had that reserve available and had it not been used this year.
So if Michael has a comment that he wants to say, and this isn't the right place, perhaps, what is the right place? Will that be?
Well, we'd have to negotiation strategy. Closed session, we can always do that.
Could we add that as part of our closed session? I know we already approved our agenda.
Technically, you could probably move to go to it now if you chose, but it could be added at the end, or it could be added at the beginning, or it could be deferred to the negotiations committee.
Because we don't get together that often as a group, and so there are things that you want to talk about, and it's, I think it's important to make that possible, because that helps us to follow the guidelines that we, you know, like, sometimes there's something you want to talk about.
The only thing I would say is generally you want to do that when you have a chance to have prepared for it, and you've thought about it.
So it's like an item that you know, everyone knows is coming.
Right.
We can plan a closed session coming up for that, for these topics. I know we were going to get the, I believe the negotiations committee, we'll be talking about negotiations committee meeting.
So in the context of the fiscal year end numbers, is there any other discussion? Okay. Bond update. I'm assuming, Greg, that's why you're here.
I received a phone call.
Fascinated by the rest of the meeting.
Well, my kids will start next year. I'll start paying attention.
You might be free dinner.
I received a call about an hour and a half ago from our fiber contractor, who has finally received the go-ahead from DTE. He will be starting next week. This is running the fiber connection from Creekside out to the bus garage. So we finally got our way through all of the DTE and AT&T.
That phone and network?
Yeah, both telephone and data will be on that. And also the security system will now operate out of the main server room. We also had a pre-bid meeting last week for the Creekside outfalls repairs that are required by the state and the village. I think we had eight bidders at the pre-bid, and then I've taken an additional three through the outdoor lab to review that. So we've been getting good response to that bid. That will bid a week from Tuesday, and I'll bring the results to the next board meeting. The other thing that is going on right now is your security consultant is doing a additional round of design, incorporating some changes at the, or some updates at the high school and also at the PA systems, I believe, Mill Creek and Cornerstone.
Now, this is a part of the already approved budget.
Already,
they're working
yeah.
within that. This isn't something new.
This was the budget approved for this summer. It's just the security design, getting everybody on board with the principals and John and Brian Pugel and everybody else. That's just getting put together now. But the budget was approved along with the work that happened this summer.
So is that primarily software and training?
Security, it's an additional camera,
the
PA systems. Creek's PA system, we update that. Wiley's to set it up so there's two sectioning, two zones, one where community ed can be turned off, one where there's emergency to everyone. And then the Bob system coming in from the high school.
From the biology team.
I have the updated, I just received, Bob sent me another updated one today. So.
The camera at the high school is the one at the main entrance that we've been, you know, talking about. What is the strategy there?
Right.
It makes the most sense. This is the first step. I don't know if it's the final step. This is something that Kit is comfortable with, and Jeremy and Brian comfortable with, that we've had the discussions about. Just getting a better view of the entrance when people are walking there.
Is it just a, it's not a push to enter system like
No, it is not.
Wiley, is it?
No, they're concerned the traffic, the amount of traffic.
Right.
We just overwhelm whoever was working that door.
So you'll just put a camera in there and see exactly what's going on?
Just so they don't feel, there are plenty of cameras on everybody
right.
coming in. They don't feel they get a good based on.
There was a discussion, I don't know, last spring maybe even, or late early summer, back in June, where we had talked about some concerns, and Kip really wasn't comfortable at things that we thought might make sense. And so it went back to he and Jeremy and whoever, a consultant and stuff, to really take a look at what they thought would work from a practical point of view, where we were maybe thinking a little more theoretical.
Yeah. This also was a result, the meeting that we had to kind of put together the design document was after Jeremy and Kit had gone through the update, I believe it's the Alice training, the newer response with the county. There's also some signage in there, numbering exits, that sort of thing. This is the most up-to-date, and it seems to be what people are comfortable with, what they think will make a difference to the program.
Yeah. It's a very frustrating discussion, I think, as we've seen over the last 3 years, because you want to have everything perfect, and there is no system that's in quotes. And so then you try to figure out what's a reasonable system that you can really implement, as opposed to what you wish you could do. So I'm sure whatever we're doing is going to be a long ways from what everybody would consider to be perfect, but it's the best we can figure out in a reasonable fashion. And that's true across the district, I think.
Any other questions for Greg?
All the summer work is pretty well, is wrapped up and ready to fall.
Good. Wrapped up and complete.
The fiber optics and the outfall are the two big things left.
Right, and then whatever the security package is. But those are the only two work packages right now.
And I have a mock-up of signs.
You do have a mock-up of signs. We can talk to the road commission about those.
So these are the road signs?
Correct, yeah.
What about signage in the building?
You know, I didn't talk to Sean before he left. I know he has spoken with and met with King Scott, it was probably 2 weeks ago, talking about this is wayfinding signage within the high school. So you go in the main entrance, where's the theater, where's the gym, where's, you know, the, I don't know what you call it, we call it the 2100 or 2700, but, you know, those classroom wings, how do you get to each of those things? So Sean has been reviewing that with King Scott, and I know they met a couple weeks ago, but I haven't heard any updates since.
So we have a bond steering committee tomorrow.
Yes.
So we'll maybe hear about that.
And is it fair to assume that once these two projects are done, we're not going to see a lot of Granger bodies around or anybody else?
Not until next year. But that's just me as a person, not as Granger. I don't think we have anything going on. That's just good.
Just nobody's surprised.
Yeah.
So this is why this is winding down.
Very much, yeah.
Most of the rest of the money is stuff that we'll be overseeing the expenditures of, and at some point we may end up with a list of maybe some money that would have some further decisions on the final spend out, or maybe not.
It's not much.
Yeah. All it's a pretty, it was a pretty successful bond issue. Every time I drive by the football field, I say, boy, that's great. Pours rain one night and they're playing out the next, you know, it's just great. Football field and the pool entrance and Mill Creek gymnasium entrance and the loop. Been a lot of good work done over the years.
I think one of the things that that struck me about this particular bond issue is it's a lot easier to build a $35 or $40 million high school than it is to spend $40 million on 100 different projects.
Right.
And I think that generated some frustrations for all parties at one time or another. I think we have to recognize the difference between this type of project and what we've been used to when we're doing big buildings.
Right.
So I had a chance to go into the Wiley pool a week or so ago, and you know, we put in the covers for that and talked to Kim, who took me around, and they've actually done some nice things with, in fact, they bought some lane lines.
Well, yeah, those are nice. You like those.
Yeah.
Yeah, they are nice. Because they have like the new like roller or whatever to roll out, and it's like so much easier to manage
connect.
And like roll around and like less heavy, easier. We're not like breaking a sweat trying to get the weight lines in the middle.
I wouldn't want to break a sweat.
Yeah. And then so we took those, the old Wiley lane lines over to the high school, because the high school lane lines were, I'm pretty sure, disintegrating in the pool, so those are awesome.
Yeah, so have you heard anything from people about the aesthetics of the covers?
Oh yeah, the covers are fine. We like them.
I said they're really fast. So
yeah,
I
fast.
Showed up in the middle of the day for swim class, and it was a very small class, and you know, all the covers were down, and I thought, oh, I said to my son, well, I guess they're probably going to cancel it, because look, it's still covered. The coach walks out, he says, oh, just a minute.
Yeah,
they just roll up, and then there was, you know, 2 minutes later, they were swimming. It was really fast.
I hate to
raise
our parade, but one of our community experts have explained to me the things we've done wrong anyway.
Well, that's the given.
I wonder who that could be.
Somebody else? I think so. Yeah, it's somebody that's heavily involved in the swimming side. That's
oh.
Not normally spending their life figuring out how to criticize.
Oh. That's actually good to hear.
You mean somebody different?
Yeah, more than one?
Just seems more democratic.
It does, yes.
Okay, anything else? Then, do you want to speak for public participation?
No. Okay, you guys are going to do
that. I'll get up and say it. There's a press in here.
Board comments.
I sort of have a question. I know we're having a meeting tomorrow night, and I was wondering, maybe what is the historical reason for calling it a retreat? Because I know around campus and around town, people have said, oh, you're having a retreat. And I have to say, well, it's actually a meeting. And so that I was wondering, is there a reason why we call? Because even I was fooled. I thought, when I first got on the board, we had that retreat. And I thought, oh, hey, we're going to have a retreat. You know? Yeah, so it's like, all right. And then it was a very nice meeting. But I'm just wondering, is there a reason?
Workshops or retreats.
This is a compromise between what we used to do and what I guess the board has decided to do in the last few years. But I think the thing that makes it separate from normal meetings is it's really intended to be an in-depth discussion with outside resources. And whether you want to call it a retreat or whatever you want to call it, we've always called those retreats in the past. Usually they were over 2 days and there was more outside participation and depending on the topic. And so this is kind of morphed into
So maybe at the retreat we can talk about what
we're
going to
talk about that. Yeah, because just in terms of people's perception of what exactly we're going to be doing, they don't understand.
It's not a day of the style.
In other words, there's no reason for it, just the way we do it.
Well, there is a distinction. In the past,
there's no need to envy the board for going on the retreat. It was kind of,
It doesn't make the headlines in the paper, but when we've had retreats in the past, we've made a commitment that absolutely no decisions will be made at a retreat.
Right.
And this has been to hopefully allow the board to have these sessions without outside uninvited participation. In the past, we've had people that have been critics in the past, but they've at least honored the intent of the retreats, and we've not had the public show up for retreats because that would really be destructive in terms of what we'd like to accomplish.
Any other comments? Okay, then I'll take